user came out of the drawing room. She asked you who was in your room. Yes, Buck Mulligan said. What did I say? I forget. He said. Stephen answered. Oh, it's only Daedalus whose mother is beastly dead. A flush which made him seem younger and more engaging rose to Buck Mulligan's cheek. Did I say that? He asked. Well, what harm is that? He shook his constraint from them nervously. And what is death? He asked. Your mother's or yours or my own? You saw only your mother die. I see them pop off every day in the modern and Richmond and cut up into tripes in the dissecting room. It's a beastly thing and nothing else. It simply doesn't matter. You wouldn't kneel down to pray for your mother on her deathbed when she asked you. Why? Because you have the first Jesuit strain in you, only it's injected the wrong way. To me it's all a mockery and beastly. Her cerebral lobes are not functioning. Absurd. She calls the doctor Sir Peter Teagle and picks buttercups off the quilt. Humor her teeth. LL is over. You crossed your last wish in death and yet you fought with me because I don't wince like some hired new from the US. I suppose I did say it. I didn't mean to offend the memory of your mother. He had spoken himself into boldness. Stephen, shielding the gaping wound which the words had left in his heart, said very coldly, I am not thinking of the offense to my mother. Aqua, then, Buck Mulligan asked. Colon, 9. Off offense to me, Stephen answered. Buck Mulligan swung round on his heel. Oh, an impossible person, he exclaimed. He walked off quickly round the parapet. Stephen stood at his post, gazing over the calm sea towards the headland. Sea and headland now grew dim. Pulses were beating in his eyes, veiling their sight, and he felt the fever of his cheek. A voice within the tower called loudly. Are you up there, Mulligan? I'm coming, Buck Mulligan answered. He turned towards Stephen and said, Look at the sea. What does it care about offenses? Chuck Loyola, hinge, and come on down. The bassinet wants his morning rashers. His head halted again for a moment at the top of the staircase, level with. He moved. Don't mope over it all day, he said. I am inconsequent. Give up your moody brooding. His head vanished, but the drone of his descending voice moved out of the spearhead. And no more turn aside and brood upon love's bitter mystery for perfect rules to draw and carve. Whose shadows floated silently by through the morning peaks from the spearhead seaward where he gazed. Inshore and farther out the Meriden, burned by light-shot hurrying feet. White breast of the dim sea, the twining stresses, two by two, a hand plucking the heartstrings merging their twining cords. Clean white wedded birds shimmering on the dim tide. A cloud began to cover the sun slowly, shadowing the bay in deeper green. It lay behind him, a pool of bitter water. Perfect song, pulsing down the long dark course. Her door was open. She wanted to hear my music. Silent, and pity I went to her bedside. with an odor of wax and rosewood, her breath bent over him with new secret words, a faint odor of wetted ashes. Her glazing eyes, staring out of death, had taken Ben my soul. On we alone, the roof candles light tragedy, ghostly light on the tortured face, her hoarse loud breath rattling in horror, while all prayed on their knees. Her eyes on me strike me down, newly out of Rutalandium chasing Vestor and Germa, cool, circumbent, Rutalandium pay version of Chorus of Scythia. Let me be and let me live. Pinch a voice. Buck Mulligan's voice sang from within the tower. It came nearer up the staircase, calling again. Demon, still trembling at his soul cry, heard one running sunlight and in the air behind him friendly words. Daedalus, come down, life is approaching. Breakfast is ready. Apologizing for waking us last night. It's all right. I'm coming, Stephen said, turning. Dude, for Jesus' sake, Buck Mulligan's